I think graphics, especially if they're being praised as being realistic, is the worst way to judge if a game will be scary.
Realistic graphics age quickly, while artistic graphics can continue to look good through their style, while enhancing other methods of inciting fear in players, such as framing, music, sound design, and a well-told story with great pacing. By focusing on those elements, a game can remain spooky and enjoyable long after the technical feats are no longer impressive. Older games like Silent Hill and modern games like Lone Survivor and Lost in Vivo are tense games that are far from running on the latest version of Unreal or RE Engine or whatever. So when looking at the original Alone in the Dark from 1992, with graphics like this and sound design like this, I'm not impressed by it, but as the progenitor of 3D survival horror, I do expect the game to deliver a creepy good time, regardless of... And despite being a survival horror fan, I've never played Alone in the Dark, and I wanted to know if it's as creepy as walking alone in the dark, or if it was the first terrible but ultimately important steps to bringing true horror to 3D video games, and if it had the power to make me go... The first thing I noticed when booting it was...
It's okay. Look, see that? It's on. It worked.
The second thing I noticed was this happened if I tabbed out for any reason, and the screen stays this size until closing and rebooting the game. But since my desk is too narrow, the smaller size was actually helpful. It also made it easier to read chat while streaming it, which I do Mondays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Eastern Time on twitch.tv/RexconJesse. Starting a new game, you have a choice between two characters, both with ties to the now dead person who owned the haunted mansion the game takes place in. There's that guy's niece, and some other dude who I didn't play because I liked her voice actor better.
The attorney's letter came as a deep shock to me.
The intro starts normal enough, but it has a definite purpose. After driving up to the house, we get a long cutscene of your character walking through the house. While it might seem unnecessarily slow, it's revealing a few important things. First, this is about the pace you need to take the game. Being fast and reckless will kill you quickly. Being slow and methodical will also kill you, but you'll die less. Probably. Second, this path is the main area of the house. Nearly everything you'll do in the mansion branches from this path. It also shows you the front door, so you know where the exit is. You continue walking until you get to the attic, which from the outside was the only room with a light on. And then, bam, you're in control. No context, no instructions, no clue as to what to do. The attic is a great opening. The multiple camera angles show how the whole game will look. There's obvious and less obvious items to collect, and there's a rocking horse that moves when you touch it, showing off the mind-blowing interactive environment. There's a lot of open space so you can get used to the tank control. Oh, that's creepy. Oh, there's a little monster going by the window.
Oh no!
Stay in the attic for a set amount of time causes a dog, duck, thing to burst through the window and attack. Which is a half segue I'm going to utilize in order to talk about the weirdest control scheme I have ever used. It's an adventure game menu awkwardly pretending to be what Resident Evil would be. You only use a few keys. Enter opens your inventory, arrow keys scroll through items and move, spacebar is select and action, and escape is for saving and quitting. But what spacebar does is entirely dependent on the action you select in the menu. So if you select search as your action, hitting spacebar searches. But if you select push, holding spacebar by that bookshelf is either going to push it or do, well, nothing. So you always have to be aware of the action you have selected. The same principle applies in combat. You have to pick a weapon, hold spacebar to ready it, then hold, not press, hold, up or down for a big attack, or left or right for a faster attack. For throwing weapons, you have to aim your character, hit enter, select the weapon, select throw, and then see how bad your aim was. However, you can throw nearly every item, including items you don't need anymore, so you usually have a few items you won't need and can use as practice throws. Assuming you're not in a fight already, because enemies can be quick. As unreasonable as that control setup sounds, I have to admit, I got used to it, and ultimately ended up kind of liking it. It's not elegant, and I'm not sure anyone should ever dare to repeat it. But it worked. There was a constant, conscious choice of what I needed to do. Having search equipped meant I could get into and out of rooms quicker. But if something got in my face, I'd probably take a hit. While having a weapon ready made me feel more safe, it also slowed me down if attacking wasn't the solution.
More important than the controls themselves is the tension they create.
It invokes a similar feeling of walking down a dark path while knowing there's something out there. Do you walk with your flashlight out to see if there's actually something in the woods? Or do you clutch a weapon in case it attacks? Having your flashlight means you'll be helpless upon seeing it, but maybe seeing it early will allow you to flee to safety. Having your weapon out means you won't see it until right before it reaches you. But if you're quick enough, you can attack it first. That constant sense of limited options adds tension. And once I got used to it, selecting different actions became almost intuitive. I can't say that without laughing. It became doable and a second cousin to enjoyable. That dual sense of hope and dread means what a zombie looks like when it bursts through the door unexpectedly doesn't matter as much as the gut-wrenching situation its arrival puts you in. So while I'd still use the phrase stiff and awkward to describe the controls, they're purposeful and functional. Which is more than I can say about the keyboard controls on other games I've played for this series. There's a great mix of useful clues, red herrings, and engaging lore scattered in books and journals throughout the game. A passionate voice actor reads every book and journal you find.
May Artemis guide us as though we were an arrow from her quiver.
The night is pitch black. I am again drenched in sweat.
Even though some of them can drag a bit, they never stopped being a joy to listen to. So piecing together clues from these texts along with trying to logically use what you have to solve problems was a blast. For the most part, solutions are sound, but when they're not logical, they are complete nonsense. For example, the final puzzle requires doing something I assumed, correctly, would destroy a key item, which I used right before this moment and I assumed I would need it in order to get out. Unexplained things like knowing you can put a lit lantern down and it still lights up the room makes sense, but experimenting like this becomes a potential problem because of one big factor. Soft locks. You can put yourself in multiple unwinnable scenarios by accidentally using key items in the wrong way or by things completely outside of your control, like not being able to re-enter a room that has a key item because you can't get past the unkillable spiders. And the game only has 6 save slots, so you have to be smart about what saves to override. The saving grace of this is that the mansion is small, like glitchless speedruns take about 11 minutes, small. Once you know what to get and where to go, you can quickly get back to where you were. So while it can be a pain, it's not the worst. Another issue is the graphics. Not how they look, but... okay, how they look, but not in a realism sort of way. What is this? I'm scared of everything that moves in this game, so I see this and run. But what was that? If I go back in the room, there it is again, despite getting very specific Silent Hill 3 vibes, I stayed in the room, which made the character start coughing. I took a guess and figured that was supposed to be a cigar and tried to solve the puzzle accordingly. And it turns out I was right, but I don't expect everyone to figure out that those brown blocks and this not ghost thing that also looks kinda like a ghost but isn't a ghost is smoke. Likewise, I didn't realize these people were supposed to be dancers, which is important for solving their puzzle. The game also has several insta-kill moments, including triggering unstoppable enemies, traps, or even reading one specific book. Though I wouldn't call these a flaw, because the game teaches you very early on that this is how the game is, and it's up to you in using your save files to outplay the game.
So with all of that in mind, is Alone in the Dark worth playing?
It got clunk. It looked chunk, but it bring the funk. If you're into survival horror games, it is an absolute must-play. Despite its shortcomings, it provides everything the best survival horror games offer, though with some clunk. If you're into puzzle or adventure games, I'd also recommend it. If you're not into any of those, it might be a bit too obtuse to get into, but I'd still recommend it to folks who have any interest. It's easy to dismiss Alone in the Dark, based on how it looks. But it goes so far beyond its base appearance to invoke fear and intrigue thanks to all it does with gameplay. Reviewers said Resident Evil 2 on the PlayStation was film-like and said it achieved true realism. And thanks to the relentless march of time tag-teaming with advancements in technology, in 20 years, we're probably going to look at Resident Evil 8 like we're looking at Resident Evil 2 right now. So if all a game has going for it is fancy-pants visuals, we'll be hyper-aware of every flaw it has when we play it in the future on our 4DK TVs that do LASIK on our eyes while we watch them or whatever. Despite a few issues and its limitations from its place in history, it's worth playing. Alone in the Dark uses the basics of horror, along with situations only possible in games, provide creative situations to get spooked by the unexpected. Hearing a noise behind you can still scare you, even if, when you get a look at it, something as silly as a rabbit trying to get subscribers on their Twitch channel.